one God, now and forever.
Reading from the book of Deuteronomy. Moses said to all Israel the words which the Lord commanded him. See, I have set before you today life and prosperity, death and adversity. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I am commanding you today, by loving the Lord your God, walking in his ways and observing his commandments, decrees, and ordinances, then you shall live and become numerous, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to possess. But if your hearts turn away and you do not hear, but are led astray to bow down to other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall perish. You shall not live long in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessing and curses. Choose life so that you and your descendants may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying him, and holding fast to him. For that means life to you and length of days, so that you may live in the land that the Lord swore to give to your ancestors, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Please join me in reading Psalm 1. Happy are they
who have not walked in the counsel of the wicked, nor lingered in the way of sinners, nor sat in the seat of the scornful.
Reading from the letter of St. Paul to Philemon. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our dear friend and co-worker, to Apphia, our sister, Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church in your house, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. When I remember you in my prayers, I always thank my God, because I hear of your love for all the saints and your faith toward the Lord Jesus. I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective when you perceive all the good that we may do for Christ. I have indeed received much joy and encouragement from your love, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you, my brother. For this reason, though I am bold enough in Christ to command you to do your duty, yet I would rather appeal to you on the basis of love. And I, Paul, do this as an old man, and now also as a prisoner of Christ Jesus. I am appealing to you for my child, Onesimus, whose father I have become during my imprisonment. Formerly, he was useless to you, but now he is indeed useful both to you and to me. I am sending Onesimus, that is my own heart, back to you. I wanted to keep him with me so that he might be of service to me in your place during my imprisonment for the gospel, but I prefer to do nothing without your consent, in order that your good deed might be voluntary and not something forced. Perhaps this is the reason Onesimus was separated from you for a while, so that you might have him back forever, no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, a beloved brother, especially to me, but how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. So, if you consider me your partner, welcome Onesimus as you would welcome me. If he has wronged you in any way or owes you anything, charge that to my account. I, Paul, am writing this with my own hand. I will repay it. I say nothing about your owing me even your own self. Yes, brother, let me have this benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. Confident of your obedience, I'm writing to you, knowing that you will do even more than I say. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
permutations, patterns miraculously sprung from binary beginnings at the word's insistence, let there be. I say God's dream for the world surpasses even the magic of zeros and ones. Yet even this way of playfully seeing the world and my place within it, differentiating what I hold true from what my forebears believe, reveals the limits of binary thinking. Admittedly, there is a comforting clarity that arises from seeing something as either this way or that way, of discerning our answers to life's incessant invitations as helpfully yes or no. Our reptilian brains, after all, are programmed to decipher potential connections as being either for us or against us. This helps us size up the world, sensing where we belong, where we feel safest, and helping us shore up our creaturely vulnerabilities. But these habits can also hamstring our ability to welcome God's reign. In today's gospel, Jesus sharpens the contrast between what we think God wants and what the inbreaking of God usually entails. A binary? I'll let you decide. One thing is clear. Jesus complicates our binary ways. He also shows the limits of our human strategies and, yes, even technologies through which we pursue success and aim to avoid failure. Which is to say, Jesus challenges our trust in ourselves. We are shaped by cultural paradigms and that famous Protestant work ethic that keeps us bound and determined to work efficiently and effectively, whether we're building a business or ushering in that kingdom that we think belongs on earth as in heaven. Jesus wants us to welcome what God is up to in the world. That may not always be clear to us. Sometimes it might even seem like a binary. But if we look and listen closely, the punchline of this pericope from Luke's gospel explodes our usual and customary categories that keep us seeing ourselves as prudent planners and faithful stewards, as opposed to those unwise ones who fail to count the upfront cost when it comes to following Jesus. If Jesus' comment that none can be his disciple without giving up all her possessions doesn't raise a few eyebrows, then we probably aren't actually listening to his provocative words this morning, which leads me to claim my own complicated relationship to this text. Oh, I've enjoyed a long and ironic chuckle as I sat with Jesus' words this week, having just spent the better part of the last month executing a cross-country move in order to come and join you here in this incredible community of faith. I assure you I did a reasonable job of donating and rehoming household goods. I absolutely did not leave all of my earthly possessions in Atlanta to embrace this spirit call to join you in the Bay Area. Yes, I'm aware of the price tag of being a person whose life relies on a certain amount of material stuff. Even as faith points me into that Godward direction where Jesus stands patient and ready, if not precisely saying, give it all up for me, baby, then at least confronting my ingrained strategies for ensuring my personal comfort and security. In this preacher hot seat, I stand meekly alongside all who hear Jesus' challenge to disciples of every place and time. Because Jesus will disrupt our binary thinking, showing binaries to be inadequate containers for receiving the gift of God's reign. Jesus has a way of showing that our habits of thinking are often about ourselves, and sometimes this monopolizes our energies in ways that tie us up and make us unavailable to the kingdom that is coming here and now. Take, for example, Jesus' examples in the gospel of building projects and peace delegations. The tower construction one brings back some memories that I have of being a part of communities that were discerning many projects, including including rebuilding a sanctuary that had been destroyed in an act of arson, and conceiving of new possibilities for ministry on a busy city block in the midst of an evolving metropolis. Long before pandemic supply chain challenges, there was always that near impossibility of projects coming in on time and under budget. Even the most savvy managers in the before times knew that our projections often miss the mark. Counting the cost is no simple endeavor, at least not as simple as strategic planning processes might lead us to believe. And often, there is that trickiness about the fault lines and interpersonal connections that start to emerge every time you talk about messing with buildings and grounds. I'm sure some of you could say more about that. Jesus is digging in to that de-escalating that's needed when it comes to peacemaking is an interesting thing for us to think about. I know there are some of us in this community that have careers in mediation, and I'm sure they could share stories aplenty about negotiations gone sideways. I have friends in lots of parts of the country that do international peace work around the world, from places like Tibet to Israel-Palestine, and they have told many stories about all the contingencies that thwart even the best laid plans for making peace. In communities, they have said again and again that the hope for the future often rests in the hands of the next generation, who seem to be a little bit more comfortable moving beyond binaries. Like many of us during pandemic lockdown, I escaped into streaming television for my daily reprieve from COVID. Madam Secretary is a personal favorite. I don't know if there are any fans out here. All right, good. Well, that marvelous show, though fictional, explores every possible permutation of global peacemaking. In under 60-minute episodes, Secretary McCord and her creative, brilliant staff swashbuckle through even the most tricky international crises, and miraculously, often at the 11th hour, seem to set the world right. Except for those rare cases when it took two episodes instead of one to pull off the impossible. These examples Jesus puts up on the board for us to consider aren't simply mental exercises. They're meant to show us the real limitations of our human technologies and strategies. We still will love our familiar logic and languages that allow us to navigate this world that is wired for connectivity, a world that seems to accelerate by the day. But even as we cling to those relationships and networks that ground us in safe space where we are seen, known, and appreciated for our gifts, we also hear Jesus' prophetic voice calling out to us, challenging our cherished habits and our preferred tendencies. You know, those ones that leave us trusting in our own devices. Not these devices. The truth remains, our human designs fall short so many times of achieving that beautiful kinship and wonderful vitality that we are made to know because of the love of our Creator. And the challenge that Jesus brings this morning, as he does every day, confronts the things that we do to make ourselves comfortable, to trust in our own confidence. He does this not just to us, but to all disciples, like he did those ones so long ago, inviting us to see that what we think faith is and what it truly can be are worlds apart, and that naturally our understanding will evolve as we welcome God's reign coming among us. of an experience she had during her first mission trip to Haiti, where the Holy Spirit revealed to her an interesting difference between the two countries. In a spiritual vision that came to her while she was praying on a bus ride, she saw this humming vitality shimmering in color and texture over the island of Haiti. This vibrancy in spite of the material lack of its people. Over there on another part of the globe, in contrast, she saw shades of gray coloring a map of the United States. On a closer look, it popped out that there were these tiny fortresses of belonging, sort of stacked high like igloos around American households, as if somehow protecting the residents. God showed her that nothing blocked the Haitians from this love of God that was showering down upon them. The Americans, though, couldn't feel and tap into that same love that was also trying to reach them because of all the material goods stacked, almost blocking it from being absorbed. Talk about complicating classic binaries. God doesn't register haves and have-nots. Her vision gave me opportunity to think about how I, too, fortified my life through possibly unhelpful attachments that could often impede the flow of God's love. If Jesus is the God who liberates, and I believe he is, then his love will transform our logic and language. It will break open our assumptions about faith and belonging. Binaries no longer will suffice to help us understand these connections that we inhabit in a world that is sustained through our Creator's care. This weekend, we have a rare moment of synergy where the scripture's invitation actually lines up with our societal habits to slow down and reflect on what fills our waking hours. Yes, Labor Day, it's an opportunity. And I hope we will spend some time for real rest from our labors. I hope we will listen to what God may be trying to help us hear in the stuff of our life. Jesus himself might find it a bit humorous, determined as we are to gravitate steadily back toward that binary, stillness and rest, contrasted to that unflagging productivity on which Silicon Valley has built its legendary competitive edge. But the truth is, Jesus wants rest and relief for all of us. And God is orchestrating the kingdom's emergence, steadily, surely, moment by moment, even when our plans and projects fall short of eternal glory. In the glimmering now, and elusive not yet, of this anything but binary heavenly kingdom, God's reign of justice, peace, and joy await. Amen.
Thank you. love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy, comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. We pray especially for Margaret Aubrey, Brock, Cindy Bodemos, Leslie Benino, Sharon B., Tayana Faave, Ann George, Dylan Gura, Cheryl Krachewski, Ruth Haynes, Larry Margolis, Jeremy Gose, John Miller, George Simon, Marisol Tria, and family. We continue to pray for the people of Ukraine, people of Russia, people of Afghanistan, people of Mexico, and every corner of the world that is experiencing turmoil, violence, and suffering. Lord, in your mercy, we commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, let us say our prayer for mission together. Glorious, gracious, and loving God,
help us this day to understand and celebrate your redeeming of the world, to be transformed in Jesus' love, and to use our gifts to make a difference for others. Amen.
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God,
we
confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed.
This is certainly a day we've been looking forward to for quite some time. Today, the Reverend Sarah Stewart leads us in worship for the first time as the new rector of St. Paul's Willingham. Sarah, welcome. We are thrilled to hear you. for Sarah at 8 a.m. and 10 a.m., after which there will be a barbecue for the entire St. Paul's community. So please attend if you can. Also today, we have the Tongan Choir joining us in worship and our summer choir.
You have to be at least in kindergarten, and we have choirs through adult age. The choir school includes grades K through 12. We actually have four youth from the choir school singing in today's summer choir. There is tuition for the choir school, very affordable rates, and need-based scholarships, and that's all made possible by the generosity of sponsorships. If you'd like to be a sponsor of the choir school, please consider reading about that in your bulletin today. We'll have, as a thank you, a soiree on the 18th, Sunday at 4, and the older youth of the choir school will offer a concert, and there will be hors d'oeuvres and drinks in the Scholars Garden.
It is such a joy and a privilege to finally be with you. Thank you all for all of your warm welcome and well wishing. As I've been thinking my transition from Atlanta, I know there have probably been emails I have missed in the packing of boxes and the swirl of activities, so if I have not responded, it doesn't mean your kindness is unappreciated. It simply means my bandwidth was maxed out. But it is going to be such an adventure to get to know you better. I hope you will stay for coffee hour after church in the coming weeks, that you'll come to some of the fall fellowship gatherings that we'll have. They'll get to meet you at the Barton room next week. Don't forget to bring your backpacks to be blessed. We have the backpack blessing next Sunday, too. So it's very, it is just an utter delight to be here. So thank you all for everything you have done to sustain this community of faith. Thank you especially to those leaders among the vestry and search committee and the buildings committee who have helped to prepare a way and to keep our community connected in this time where we've been re-emerging. I hope those of you who have been on the fence, maybe those of you who are joining us virtually, will come on back and can reconnect with all the people here who love you and who look forward to seeing you, as indeed I do, in the coming weeks. So let us walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering, a sacrifice to God.
Blessed be thou living tree, blessed be.
heaven and earth. For by water and the Holy Spirit you have made us a new people in Jesus Christ our Lord, to show forth your glory in all the world. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Thank you.